Would the honorary degree recipient please come to center stage? The citation reads as follows. Today, Georgetown recognizes one of the most respected interviewers in the history of broadcast. During a career that has spanned more than four decades, Charles Pete Rose Jr., Charlie Rose, has employed the medium of television to share with his viewers an experience of rigorous conversation with everyone from Yahoo CEO Marissa Meyer to South Africa's president, Nelson Mandela. Science, philosophy, politics, art, business, sports, technology, literature, and entertainment. He leaves no corner of our culture unexamined, engaging us in the pressing issues of the day. In this era of instantaneous global communication, when 500 million tweets are broadcast daily, his careful, patient journalism helps all of us to navigate the complexities and challenges of the 21st century. Charlie Rose grew up in Henderson, North Carolina, where as a young boy, he lived near a train route that ran from Miami to Boston. When a northern-bound train would pass by, he would think, "Wouldn't I love to be on that?" He yearned for a bigger life, to go places and to meet all sorts of people. After attending Duke University and receiving degrees in history, then law, Mr. Rose pursued a career in banking, but ultimately discovered this was not his calling and instead gambled on his instinct. "Whenever I look back," he said recently, "I know I learned more from when I said yes than when I said no." He made his way to television news, originally behind the scenes, but quickly finding his real home in front of the camera at CBS. A former CBS News anchor, now anchor of CBS This Morning, he also co-hosts Person to Person, contributes to 60 Minutes, and hosts the long-running Charlie Rose Show, a beloved daily interview program on PBS that premiered in 1991. CBS was also the home of one of his heroes, Edward R. Murrow. 26 years prior to Rose's arrival at CBS in 1984, Murrow, in a famous speech to industry insiders, laid out his concerns, but also his hopes for what he termed this weapon of television, engaged in a great and perhaps decisive battle to be fought against ignorance, intolerance, and indifference. Television, Murrow warned, can teach, it can illuminate, yes, and even it can inspire, but it can do so only to the extent that humans are determined to use it to those ends. Throughout his long career, Charlie Rose has used television to teach, illuminate, and even to inspire us. He has repeatedly proved that television, in his words and in his practice, has soul, depth, and range. And in doing so, he has fulfilled Murrow's prophecy in extraordinary ways, transforming a weapon into an instrument of insight. Today, then, Georgetown University delights to honor a citizen and journalist whose life and work both exemplify this institution's commitment to a conversation that bows to the past and beckons to the future. And with pride and pleasure, Georgetown University confers upon Charlie Rose the degree Doctor of Humane Letters honoris causa.
By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Congress of the United States and by the Board of Directors of Georgetown University, I officially confer upon Charles Pete Rose the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters honoris causa. And it's now my pleasure to present to you Mr. Charlie Rose, who will deliver the commencement address.
First of all, what a day for a graduation. And how appropriate is it that Georgetown is on a hilltop? To President Joya, to the provost, to Dean Gillis and other deans, to the faculty, to the board of directors, and to the students, to the alumni and families and all those who received degrees and honorary degrees this weekend, I am honored, very honored, to join you, to be with you. Thank you, Georgetown, for my honorary degree. I think it was Ronald Reagan who said, "My classmates thought the first degree I received was an honorary degree." That applies to me, but certainly not the other honorees being acknowledged across this campus this weekend, many of whom I met last night. I want you to know, all of you undergraduates, that I am so proud to be a Hoya today. That's right, Coach K. On this day, I'm a proud Hoya. This university should be special to me. I'm a neighbor from 33rd Street in Volta. And now, because of the good graces of President Joya, I have a library card. I have an admission to the gym. I may go to a lecture now and then. So I'm fully part of Georgetown now. I am proud also to be part of what Georgetown is and what it aspires to be, from Archbishop John Carroll in 1789 to President John de Gaulle in 2015. Georgetown has had what every great institution needs: inspired teaching. I congratulate the president on his commitment to strong leadership. That too is a Georgetown tradition. How many kings, presidents, prime ministers, and key government officials from around the world can one university educate? What other American university has two living kings among its alumni? I could probably fill at least 6 months of interviews of all the Georgetown alumni. I could fill a month with just those that I have interviewed, from King Abdullah to Bradley Cooper. We could actually form a government right here. We could take all of these people, you included, and form a government. The university has produced amazing graduates from all professions and for all professions, including one stunningly smart and beautiful lady that sits beside me every morning at CBS This Morning. She is, of course, Nora O'Donnell, class of 1995 and 2003, and her husband, Jeff Tracy, also a Georgetown graduate, class of 1995. He has a degree in theology, and he owns restaurants. Imagine my surprise when I realized that Nora married a Georgetown graduate who can both forgive and cook. Not only that, runs a giant corporation, a great corporation, and can run the triathlon and go participate in that and run a marathon as well. My good friend Bradley Cooper, who I share the same birthday, although I was born a few years earlier, wanted to be here and he intended to be on stage with us this afternoon, but found himself on another stage in London for the premiere of his great play in which he stars, The Elephant Man. Most commencement speeches, as you know, begin with a nod to the nature of commencement speeches. Mine shall not be quite as short as one by Harold Hyde. He said, "Know yourself, Socrates. Control yourself, Cicero. Give yourself, Christ." And then he went and sat down. Someone did say to me as I walked in, I hope that my favorite two words of your commencement speech are not "in conclusion." I will not keep you long because this is your day. You have been listening for 4 years. It is time to celebrate. To get here, you have been through high expectations, low comedy, close calls, moments of pride and doubt, and now exhilaration. And I cannot imagine how much beer and pizza. You know, you're here today to continue a story and start a new chapter. It is the most important story, your story. Only you can create your story from your own life. All we can do is share our experiences. There is an end to every journey, but it is the journey that matters in the end. We talked this morning about your journey. Make no mistake, most of us here would rather be where you are, because every single day there becomes around us a more interesting world and a more challenging world. You will live longer, you will have more opportunities that many of us cannot even comprehend. Everything is changing at a Mach speed. Take science and technology. 3D technology today from a printer can make a gun or a new hand. It is accessible to all, for good and for bad. Same thing for social media. Twitter energized revolutions in the Middle East, but it also is used as a powerful recruiting tool for terrorism. In medicine, thanks to stem cell developments and the genetic progress, blindness may be cured in the next 10 years. There is extraordinary progress in treating cancer. In brain science, the velocity of change is stunning. Artificial intelligence is no longer science fiction. The dawn of AI, as it is called, offers huge benefits. Stephen Hawking, you remember the movie The Theory of Everything, the great physicist from Cambridge, has said this: the development of artificial intelligence could signal the end of the human race. There's also biology, where the possibility of changing everything before birth. At Sun Yat-sen University in China, researchers edited the genes of human embryos. They took out a bad one and they put in a good one. A recent MIT Technology Review cover story entitled "Engineering the Perfect Baby" said, "Scientists are developing ways to edit the DNA of tomorrow's children. Should they stop before it is too late?" One more time, science moves forward with great concerns about the consequences for the rest of the genome and the real fear of eugenics. The common denominator in all of this is the velocity of change. And yet, in this world today, where so much is new, so much is old. Just last week, thousands died in Nepal from an earthquake, and historic violent conflict continues as it has for centuries, at the same time finding even more barbaric and visible ends. Omnipresent cameras with all kinds of smartphones make this the age of transparency, again, for good or bad. It is a hugely interesting time to go out in the world. If the economy gives you a place to stand, and it should, and you will make us all very proud by what you can do and find your place to deal with all these very complex issues. My generation has made significant contributions, but we have not done as well as we should. We have not found political solutions to war. We have not found the political will to stop destroying the planet. So you have your work cut out for you. My generation cannot recapture our time, but we can share experiences. And I'll tell you this afternoon, with a lifetime of questioning, listening to the stories of everyone from the playing field to the battlefield, I come as one who plays a role in the conversation of America from four perches, three perches and one kind of perch. Charlie Rose, CBS This Morning, and 60 Minutes. It is stories that I seek there. Sometimes they're men and women of great achievement and fame, but all too often we pay too much attention to fame. Many times I see remarkable responses by people who, in small acts, without applause, do good things because of the character within them. Fame is not their goal. Service is their goal. I see inspired moments of courage from individuals who simply did the right thing because they were called on in a demanding moment. It never occurred to them to do anything else. Fame is not their goal. Duty was. Since 10 is the magic number for List, just one of the many wonderful things that David Letterman has given us on television in 33 years, I have a top 10 list of the fundamental lessons that I have taken from all those stories, from all those guests. Know yourself. Know who you are. Know your values. Know your strengths and weaknesses. And know what you love, really love, and make that your passion. You define yourself. Accept no limitations on your dreams. Accept no limits because of race or gender or national origin. You are who you say you are. When someone else says you are, you define who you are. Know something larger than yourself. Lose yourself in greater good, as parents find themselves doing with their children, or soldiers do on the battlefield. Find places and ideas where you can lessen suffering and enhance knowledge. Make your life your story. and you are the actor and the director and the star. As the Nobel laureate and Irish poet Seamus Heaney said, all the directions have to be personal discoveries rather than prescribed routes. They are to be improved rather than copied. They are to be invented rather than initiated. They are to be risked and earned rather than bought. 5, take action. Take action. Make choices. Oliver Wendell Holmes once said, to reach the port of heaven, we must sail, sometimes with the wind, sometimes against the wind, but always sail and not drift and lie at anchor. Work matters. No one has ever come up to me in an interview and sat across the table from me and said, the reason I am here, the reason that I'm at this table is because I was smarter or anything else. What I have achieved is because I worked harder than everybody else, because I wanted it and cared more about it. Failure will happen to you. Make it your teacher and your motivator. And be accountable. Don't be afraid to say to yourself and to others, I failed. Don't be afraid to say, I'm sorry. People will matter, as it has already. We have lots of friends here at this university. Relationships matter, and friends matter. They have shared your hopes and your disappointments and your successes and your failures. Keep them in your memory and your speed dial. Take a moment to smile and make someone's day. I promise it will make your day. And be a little crazy at the same time. There was an ad I saw once that said, here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs and the square holes, the ones who see things different. They are not fond of rules. They have no respect for the status quo. You can praise them. You can disagree with them. You can quote them. You can disbelieve them. You can glorify them. You can vilify them. About the only thing you cannot do is you cannot ignore them. They change things. They invent things. They imagine things. They heal and they explore. They inspire and they push the human race to go forward. Maybe they have to be crazy. How else can you stare at an empty canvas as a painter and see a work of art, or sit in silence and hear a song that has never been written, or gaze at a red planet and see a laboratory on wheels? The people who are crazy enough to think that they can change the world are the ones that can change the world. And I know they're among you, those people. The two principles that I carry with me most today are these. Think ahead to the end of your life. And think about what you would like to be remembered for at the end of your life. It's not honor, it's not prestige, it is character, it is integrity, it is truth. It is doing the right thing. It's hard to imagine or think about that when you're 22. It's easy when you're 73. David Brooks, in his new book, The Path to Character, says, it's the difference between your resume and your eulogy. It's the difference between ambition and service. Second, I hope all of you will live deeply in the moment. See, hear, feel, touch, breathe deep of life. Bill Murray, the actor and comedian, said to me in an interview, the secret for me is to be alert and to be available. Be in the arena now. If you have a bucket list, start now. John Lennon once said, life is what happens when you're busy making other plans. Tom Brokaw on a recent show said to me, it's a mistake not to go. You don't know whether it is around the corner or in the curve. One day all is well and the next all is gone. Engage now. A friend of mine was Bill Buckley, the great editor, now deceased, and he would always say to me, let's go sailing. Let's come up to Connecticut and let's go sailing. And for whatever reason, for so many times, I said I had something else to do, and I didn't go sailing with Bill. And then one day, I said, let's go sailing, Bill. And he said, I don't sail anymore. And I hadn't acted in the moment, and I hadn't been there for him, and I'll always regret it. Toni Morrison, the great Nobel laureate, asked me to go to accept with her to accept the award, and I had something else to do, and I didn't go. I didn't seize the moment. and I've regretted it for all my life. One day is a well that you can drink so deeply in and find so much if you are just alert and available to it. Before you know it, you'll be here. Each of you will be here to salute your son or your daughter. It will come, I promise you, faster than you can imagine, as it did for your parents. And before we go, I want every parent and grandparent, every mother and every father, every brother and every sister, every son and every daughter of a graduate to know, as we have already said at this podium, we owe you, we appreciate you, and we love you for giving to this university an opportunity to give something special to your child, which was the capacity to learn. So, as every graduate leaves here, certainly with memories, but also with a paper in your hand, with knowledge in your head, and passion in your heart, you know that you have our confidence that you will write your own story, that you'll make the world better, and that you will have fun. First this morning, this afternoon, the diploma, and then the world. Oops, I stand corrected. First the diploma, and then the party. Thank you very much.